I'm sorry, I'm your host, Dr. Danny Purcell, coming live and online from the beautiful campus of California State University in Dominguez Hills. That's a mouthful. Welcome, everybody, to Session 12. We have this semester that's been going by pretty quickly, maybe not so much for students this class, but it's been going pretty quickly for me. I'm really excited today. We're talking all about writing, and I'm also going to show a whole bunch of video clips. I realize there's a whole bunch of video clips over the semester I haven't gotten to, so some of them are random today, but they're very funny. They might have a lot of different funny clips and some inspirational clips as well. This is an interactive class. You don't have to be enrolled in the class to participate. Two ways to participate. First of all, feel free to give us a call at 1-800-339-1193 or send us an email at dhtb.csudh.edu. I'm really excited to hear from you today. Let me see my question of the day for you, because we're really going to focus on ESL writing today. So how do you promote writing with your ESL students? There we go. How do you promote writing with your ESL students? I'd love to hear. You know, well, before I forget, I'm going to give you your magic word for students enrolled in the class. I'm going to give you the magic word right now. The magic word this week is volcano. For those of you that are watching, the magic word is volcano. I'm going to give it to you right at the beginning of class today. You never know what I'm going to give it to you. So I hope you're watching every episode. Next week, you're going to have we're going to have a special guest presenting. It's going to be Dr. Sharon Russell. She's the former chair of the teacher education department. We can remove the magic word. I don't want people to have it too long on the screen. Sharon Russell's going to talk to us about how to meet the needs of special education ESL students. Actually, it's one of the things I've been talking about all semester. So that's good for ESL students. It's good for all students. A lot of the strategies that we've been using and talking about this semester are things that work really well with our special needs students. I actually like the term special needs students because I actually feel all students have special needs. They're just very different. So that's what we're talking about next week. So this week we're focused on writing. So our goals for this session, by the end of the session, we will be able to identify the stages of writing development for our ESL students. We'll understand how the writing workshop guides ESL students in their writing processes and recognize important issues to pay attention to in our ESL students' writing. So give us a call at 1-800-339-1193 to tell us how you're promoting ESL writing with your ESL students, where you're doing promote writing with your ESL students, or send us an email at dhtb.csudh.edu. Class is always so much more fun when I get to hear from all of you. It's very tough staring at a camera. I'll tell you how tough it is staring at a camera. So before we went on the air, they had an awkward angle for one of the cameras. I'm sitting there looking at the back of my head. Oh my gosh, I'm going bald. I had to be like, was it John and Kay? John got that hair transplant. They got to get the hair transplant. And I am going bald. It is crazy for hair time. Anyway, let's get back to writing. Why writing? Well, writing is to reading as exhaling is to inhaling. Both are individual processes, but each depends highly on the other. While many good readers are not good writers, I've known lots of good readers that aren't good writers, but I've never met a good writer that's not a good reader. So reading and writing are very closely linked. And next weekend, make sure, a lot of you don't know yet, we talked about it a couple weeks ago, I think we talked about it last week, was next weekend, UCLA has the LA Times Festival of Books on the UCLA campus. It's free to the public. All you have to do is pay for parking, but your parking fee goes to benefit local literacy nonprofits. It's just a wonderful format. We have a family, especially. They have tons of great kids authors there. Everybody goes. You get big names all the time. It's really pretty cool. And then, if you're into movies, like a lot of screenwriters, it's interesting because I find a lot of screenwriters because nobody ever pays attention to screenwriters. I think it's fantastic. It's all screenplays and stuff. It's really cool. Thanks. Make sure you take the family, go to the UCLA Festival of Books next week. For ESL students, writing is no longer some activity that comes after students learn to speak. We realize we talked about the four aspects of language acquisition here all semester. They are reading, writing, listening, and speaking, and they all have to be developed spontaneously and simultaneously. It's very important. We know that speaking and listening are vital it's about reading, writing on all seven. We're going to really try and work on all of these. One of the best ways I know to work on enhancing one's vocabulary is by doing crossword puzzles. I've actually never looked at the research on this, but I'm convinced that people that do crossword puzzles have vocabulary which is about 5 times more sophisticated than people that aren't doing crossword puzzles. You should try and it's a great mental exercise, and the more you do them, the better you get at them. And there was a great documentary that came out about 5 or 6 years ago called Wordplay. I'm going to show you 3 different clips from that movie. This first clip, the wordplay is about Will Shortz has been editing the New York Times crossword puzzle for I don't know how long, at least 25 years. He's actually also hosts a great show on National Public Radio. I think it's on the weekends where he's talking about puzzles and things like that. It's fantastic. And so there's a whole movie about this this clan of different individuals that are addicted to crossword puzzles that come from all walks of life, from Mike Mussina, former pitcher for the New York Yankees, to John Stewart, the comedian, to this next person who is an executive solver. So we're going to enjoy this first clip from the movie Wordplay. It's about a 3.5 minute clip about a chief executive word solver. So enjoy this clip from the movie Wordplay.
Schools are closed for a while today. Before any of those children thought the New York Times had been particularly favored to help at the Times crossword puzzle. The clue is the same for numbers 39 and 43 across on each story in tomorrow's newspaper. 39 across, 43 across, elected. Surely the Times won't go up on a new life in it. No crossword editors much to the bubble. So if you need a few words in the answer to 3943 from CS, Bob Dole, elected.
Yes, just a CS puzzle. To be clear, it was blank elected. It blank is simple because they could become a part of the Bob Dole editors, and they can both because they figured out 7. Saying is there will be a URL going to be here or there. far worse than the condition that you were. Remember the day you
opened your movie is called Wordplay. Yeah, on Netflix, great little documentary film. It's really fascinating. I became such a fan of Will Schultz after watching the movie. Don't get to see it and him in that clip, but the editor of the New York Times Puzzles is really a pretty cool guy. And I really liked some of the things that President Clinton was talking about there is, you know, they get through like 50 of the clues before they actually notice the answer to one. And I liked how he said, you know, crossword puzzles are really good at preparing you for life, trying to find something that you understand and building upon that. It's really a good piece of advice to all of our ESL students as well as, you know, it takes time and it can be frustrating, but you take what you know and you build upon that. And I really think that's something that we can apply to everything. So, how do we create our ESL writers? How do we get them excited about writing? You know, you need to give them plenty of time and opportunities to write for one. You know, in this day and age, we have scripted programs, and kids are doing worksheets all the time. I've been observing so many classes where I just see the kids filling out worksheet after worksheet. It's very uncreative to me. To me, that's not writing. You know, worksheets do have a place in the curriculum, but when it's just overwhelming the curriculum, where every teacher's on the same page, on the same day, you know, because all the teachers both think about how the test scores have gone up so high at our school, and I wonder what cost the test scores are going up. You see a bunch of miserable kids that are bored about school and they have no interest in school whatsoever. I'm going to show you a clip from a documentary later on today called 2 Million Minutes, where it compares a couple of high school students from the United States, India, and China, and their different attitudes towards education. And you just can see how the American kids are like, you know, I'm sick of school, and I'm just want to party, and stuff like that, where a lot more competition happening there in India and China. It's just it's something to all think about. You need to give your kids a purpose to write. You know, I see so many mindless activities. Again, this gets back to a lot of those scripted programs, you know, like today we're going to learn about the suffrage movement. I'm going to give you no context except for this one paragraph from your textbook, and you're going to write about the suffrage movement in the United States. And I'm going to, you know, and I don't really want to get down all the scripted programs, but something that really should be happening is I think a scripted program works really well, especially when a beginning teacher doesn't know what to do. I think what a really good teacher can do, though, is to use that curriculum and then enhance it. I should have brought the clip from the movie Teachers. The movie Teachers back in 1984 with Nick Nolte and Joe Beth Williams. The best thing about the movie, though, is it's this inner city high school. It's completely dysfunctional. And Richard Mulligan plays this escaped, insane patient from an insane asylum. And he just enters, they think he's a substitute teacher, and they let him teach at the school. Well, it turns out he becomes the best teacher at the school. Like when he's teaching history, and he's teaching Washington's trip across the Delaware, the crossing of the Delaware. You know, the kids are actually helping him paddle boats, and they reenact it. He's always dressing up his characters and stuff, and he made it so much more interesting. Meanwhile, the tenured teacher just sits there and gives all worksheets that he reads a newspaper every single day and falls asleep. And there's actually one scene where everybody thinks he's asleep all day because he's always asleep. It turns out he died. Took him 6 years before they figured out the guy was dead. But like that, unfortunately, it's happening in a lot of schools. So yeah, you know, your kids' purposes to write. You know, it doesn't have to be a formal reading assignment, too. I mean, think about it. There's writing for academic purposes, and there's writing for expressive purposes. So, you know, have your kids write letters, like through a pen pal or something. You know, there's a great book by Frank McCourt. Frank McCourt, unfortunately, passed away last year. He won the Pulitzer Prize for an incredible book, Angels and Ashes, which is one of the greatest books ever. But he taught high school in New York City for over 30 years, and you know, his book Teacher Man talks about those 30 years, and one of the greatest ideas he has in that book is he had all these reluctant writers in his classroom. They would never write anything for him, and yet every single day he was receiving notes from parents that he knew were forced by the kids to explain it, why she used absences and things like that. And so one day he typed up all their forged notes and handed them out to everybody, and everybody's like, what's this? He's like, these are letters from parents. And he's like, so what's that all about? He's like, yeah, you all wrote them. You all forged them. And they all confessed it. Oh, these are actually really well-written notes. finding that you're interested in reading, and I think that you can write really well. So right now we're going to have a contest to see if you can write the best forged note, you can write the best excuse letter. And so all of a sudden, the kids are like, oh, so they all start writing excuse notes, and kids that would never write, you know, the bells, I mean, they're still excited about writing. And then you started giving them assignments like, okay, you're Adam or you're Eve, you're writing a note to God explaining why you read from the forbidden tree. You know, and he gave them different assignments like that, and it's just wonderful. That's what a great teacher does, they build upon the interest of their students and give them some purposes. You know, your kids writing grocery lists, get them writing their top 10 favorite American Idol moments, give them purposes for writing. Give them audience. Audience is very important to get kids excited about writing. And, you know, your example, my daughter, Katie, she was born 2 months prematurely. And so she spent 6 weeks in the intensive care unit in the hospital. And so I'm in the hospital in the ward for the intensive care unit, and there's all these babies in these bubbles, and there was nothing to read in there. And gave me an idea, so we started in this classroom to start writing books and donating to the hospital. And guess what happened? Those kids started writing like crazy because they had an audience. You want to get your kids excited about writing, have the kids write books to donate to the hospital or to the senior center, have them write letters to the editor of newspapers. I can tell you, I used to be a journalist, and in my experience, kids have a much higher percentage of possibility of getting published in the newspaper than adults. I'll give you an example. My sister lives, you know, she works for the federal court system. She's a badass. I'm not. But when she was 8 years old, she wrote a letter to the editor of the Des Moines Register, which to this day is the single most responded to letter to the editor of that newspaper. It's one of the oldest newspapers in America. And they published it on Sunday, Des Moines Register, and it went, Dear Des Moines Register, my name is Elizabeth. I am 8 years old. My class had a project. We each had to write about a state. Every kid got a state. I got Iowa. Every kid wrote the Chamber of Commerce. Every other kid got a letter back from the State Chamber of Commerce. I didn't get anything back from Iowa. My mommy says it's because there's nothing to see in Iowa. Well, over the next 3 months, we got over 9,000 letters from Iowa sending us pink t-shirts and corn, all kinds of crazy stuff. It was such an overwhelming response. The very next week, the Sunday edition of the Des Moines Register published a one-page editorial entitled, Yes, Elizabeth, there is no Iowa, and it showed all the things there are to do in Iowa, and then they sent her the metal plate that they have published it on. I mean, that's three rules for it, huh? You know, get your kids writing, give them a purpose for writing, and give them an audience when they're writing. And look at models. You know, our students need models. Kids aren't going to be able to write very well if they don't see really good pieces of writing. It's one of those little trivia pieces of your Clavin fact of the day. Of all professionals, who are the worst spellers? Of all professionals, who are the worst spellers? And here's the answer. Teachers. Why? Because teachers are constantly grading papers where they see tons of mistakes, and so those mistakes become embedded in their heads. You know, if we're always talked about having positive role models all the time, you know what? It's like that. Practice doesn't make perfect. Practice makes perfect. You need a good role model. When you see the good role model, you know, I was using the example of Shaquille O'Neal's free throws. If Shaquille O'Neal had a really good model that he had done, always visualizing that model, that's how he would improve his free throw shooting percentage. You know, probably now it's lost cause, but it doesn't matter. He's been quite successful without it. If you want to create a safe and supportive environment for your students, this is again for all students, not just all ESL students, but you need to create a safe and supportive environment. We're going to show a couple of clips about that later on. Provide ongoing support to your students. One of the best ways to do this is through writing a workshop, and we'll go into detail about writing a workshop. Give your students plenty of feedback. What can they improve? What are they doing really well? And again, you want to build a community of writers. Get them. Your kids so that they're willing to share what they're writing. You know, it's interesting. I don't know if this is actually a true story, so if I'm incorrect, correct me. I heard the story that there was this UCLA screenwriting class, and there was this one guy, and he had this script, and he was hard at selling the script, and group in his class, they read the script and they just ridiculed him. They said, this is horrible, this is the trashiest script ever, it's unbelievable, and the guy actually committed suicide. And, you know, everybody felt horribly, and a week later, a movie studio actually bought his script, and they made it into the movie. The movie script was called Leaving Las Vegas, and won an Academy Award for Nicolas Cage for Best Actor. I don't know if that's a real story, but that's a pretty amazing story. It shows you, you know, how critical it is to build a community of writers when people are supportive. You know, you can point to, use some people's writing, but do it in a tactful way. You know, everything's about tact. Okay, now, this next clip I want to show you some funny clips today. There's a great comedy show that's no longer on from, it's called Kids in the Hall. I used to love Kids in the Hall. So, this next clip has nothing to do with writing whatsoever. It does have to do with speaking English as a second language. So, it's about a 2.5 minute clip about if this person speaks English at all. Just enjoy this really brief clip from the Kids in the Hall.
I'm sorry, I'd love to be of assistance to you, but I'm afraid I speak no English. Pardon? I see by the expression on your face that you're confused by my statement. Perhaps you doubt its veracity, but let me assure you, I speak not a word of English. Oh, what are you talking about, huh? I've seen to, I've learned to speak phonetically. As to the meanings of the individual words or the per common rules of syntax, I haven't a clue. Why don't you just shut up and tell me about the true story, son? You jerk. Allow me to reiterate, I speak no English. Perhaps this will wash the confusion from your face, my friend. The apparent fluency is the result of constant repetition. And as you can imagine, I've been through this speech many times before. In fact, I can repeat it for you in any one of 7 different languages. Yet, oddly enough, I've never learned to speak in my own, which is fine, since over the years I've forgotten how to speak my own language.
Just shut up and tell me what your story is, huh?
Thank you. Would you like to fight me now, or are you a coward?
We'll die.
I don't know what you're saying.
I just wanted to buy a pair of shoes, huh?
No, I'm not Spaniel, senor.
Just let me go buy shoes.
I can say no age.
So while we were watching that clip, I got an email from Max. Max, thank you so much for emailing. Max writes, I help students understand the limited application of the 5-paragraph essay. That seems to help students engage with writing once they can see that academic writing is only one avenue of expression, not the avenue. I like that. I think that's very important that you're doing that, Max. There are 2 different types of writing. Well, let's just say 2 different types, but you have writing for academic purposes and writing for expressive purposes. One of the things I point out to kids is 5-paragraph essays are good, all fine and good, but I think one of the reasons a lot of kids hate writing is because a lot of adults hate writing. Because a lot of us were taught just with the 5-paragraph essay, and 2, the max spends on 5-paragraph essay is one type of writing. But writing is also poetry, writing is songs, writing is grocery lists, things like that. So I appreciate the email, Max. You can email back anytime. So let's talk about stages of writing development. Now, for a native speaker, there's basically 3 types of writers out there. First off, you have your emergent writers. This is for your really young kids. Your emergent writers, they're really just starting to grasp how to write. So they start off with random symbols and maybe like just lines and circles and things like that. And then they actually start getting the actual letters of the alphabet. So like, also first grader writes IKSKP, and an incredible first grader teacher reads IKSKP, and they're like, oh, you like IKSKP? Yay! I'm also amazed when teachers can do that. I always think of Indiana Jones. You know, you ever watch Raiders of the Lost Ark? The great thing about that movie is you can put a stone tablet in front of Harrison Ford, and he can immediately read whatever Sanskrit is there. Oh, the Ark of the Covenant is located. I mean, hesitate, but a lot of first grade teachers are doing when they're reading words from writers' writing. And then you get your beginning writers, and beginning writers, they have lots more spelling errors, and they might have some syntax errors, things like that. But even somebody like me can actually figure out what the kid's writing is. The kid writes something like, I gained my Osen to visit to my Ungan moment. You know, so the kid sounds German, but even I can understand he's talking about visiting his grandma or something like that. You get your personal writers, you get your community writers, and then you get your transitional writers, and these kids are really starting to master writing. They're starting to become much more conventional in their writing. They can actually pretty much point out everything that they want. You know, so you have a kid that writes, I had a very happy Christmas. My family went to Disneyland for 2 days. These are the kids that start getting infatuated with exclamation points. That's one of the things I like to work on with kids, and like, use punctuation marks. They actually mean something. It means change the tone of your voice. I don't know if any of you remember on the great show, The Electric Company, which I was speaking in Chicago yesterday, and half the audience had never heard of The Electric Company. It made me feel like an old guy. An old guy playing metal. It's unbelievable. I was talking about the old comedian Victor Borg. Victor Borg was just a wonderful comedian. He always used to sit behind the piano. He's an incredible piano player, he is. And he'd tell jokes and play different pieces of music. But one of the things he used to do in Electric Company was he'd read aloud stories. And when he read aloud stories, he also read aloud the punctuation. So he'd read all like I don't remember exactly how it went, but like a period was, and an exclamation point was, and quotation marks were things like that. It was just so much more fun listening to him read a lot of story. And I used to do my kids doing it. It's fantastic. Actually, if you go online, like on eBay or Amazon or anything, they have actually the best of the Electric Company DVD series. And these are just filled with tons of great teaching ideas. I think every teacher, especially a first or second grade teacher, is very wise to purchase them. They're great for parents. Sesame Street is written for kids up to about age 6, and the old Electric Company was written for kids around ages 6 to 9, like your first, second, and third graders. Just valuable strategies in those. So we have our for negative language, we talk about immersion writers, beginning writers, and transitional writers. Well, most of our ESL students that we're getting in our classrooms, unless they're a real little kid that's never had any kind of schooling, we're receiving these transitional writers. So what's the difference for our ESL students? Well, our beginning ESL students already understand sounds, full correspondence, and writing. They're more, they need to understand that. Like, if it's a Spanish-speaking kid, that's a real benefit to us because Spanish and English both have the same alphabet system, so the alphabet system is the same, so it's a lot easier for this kid to transition into native language writing. It would be much more difficult for, say, a Korean student that has a totally different type of alphabet to deal with. What beginning ESL students require most is beginning vocabulary. And this is our biggest. I've written now 3 books on vocabulary. I think vocabulary is really a key to helping all students, but definitely with our ESL students. They're really just lacking a lot of those vocabulary words, focusing on a lot of those. And I love that flipping kids in the hall is using some of these extremely long vocabulary words, which I think is fantastic. All right, I've been talking long enough. Let's get to another clip. This is a clip again from the movie Wordplay. This is about this young college student that's just amazing at crossword puzzles. I'm going to give away the ending. He actually wins the national crossword exam. I think he's the youngest person ever to win the competition. So enjoy. This is about a 1.5-minute clip. This kid's name is Tyler Hinman, and he was the national crossword puzzle champion back about 5 or 6 years ago. About a 1.5-minute clip.
Siri info. 8-letter word for disorder. Irish time for a Sunday hour time to lead us on the 16-minute range. Let's rock. I'm talking to the professor about tech institute from New York, and I come up here and I see her cross the puzzle. Well, let's start out puzzles. I have 19 couple children's fun puzzles. I need to figure out fat cat lines and fat long voice spells words. And then in 9th grade, I got handed a crossword for instead of all, and I did it. Failed miserably, so it's cool.
water from Ford's office is the best engineer machines that are as smart as we are.
Struggling. To me, the tip is, know, obviously you're a good parent because you've called into the show, you're showing some concern about that. I mean, you are that key factor, Lourdes. Just continue to encourage her. The fact that she's a good reader is awesome. I mean, keep on building on that. And show her a lot of different types of writing because she might actually be good at a certain type of writing that she hasn't really been exposed to yet. I find a lot of kids, they might struggle with a little bit of the academic writing, but they do really well when it comes to writing poetry or writing song lyrics and things like that. So that time and time again. And might do some writing games. I mean, that's why I'm showing clips from the movie Wordplay. There's crossword puzzles. I don't know if the LA Times does anymore. They used to have some newspapers, used to have these little great kids sections where the kids have little crossword puzzles and things like that, but you can always go to the bookstore and get like Mad Libs are a great way to get the kids excited about writing. I do know the LA Times still does Scrabblegrams, scramble up letters and kids have to put them back in the right order. Have her just encourage her to write stories. My daughter is kind of crashing her floor this after we watched Spider-Man. She wrote her own book about the adventures of Spider-Girl because she wanted a girl superhero. So by encouraging her that way, I think that's the best way. Is that helping out at all, Lourdes? Great. Thank you for calling. Call back anytime. I really appreciate the phone call. Great for Lourdes. She got the phone lines opened up. I always appreciate that very first phone call. And I really meant that when I said Lourdes is folks. I mean, parents make a huge difference. Lourdes is obviously a good parent. I mean, she's watching a show about education. She's concerned for her child. And I don't think it's ever a bad idea to be an overly concerned parent. I think it's a very important thing. You need to be really encouraging kids. The parents are that number one factor, I think, really being involved all the time. So I really appreciate that, Lourdes. You call back anytime. So we talked about how many ESL students are here, and many ESL students are advanced CSL students. We want to give them a lot more challenging work. Advanced CSL students are usually very much like our native English speakers, so we give them plenty of essays, report formats, science, we have to do lab manuals, take home exams, things like that. I'd like to ask a new question and see what your responses are. How do you differentiate writing activities for your beginning, intermediate, and advanced ESL students? Here we go. How do you differentiate writing activities for your beginning, intermediate, and advanced ESL students? We're trying to talk about differentiating instruction. It's one of the things I always say. You can teach every standard to every student in your classroom. Some students get the standard here, and some kids get it here, and that's our job as teachers to help these kids come up to here. And then when we're talking about differentiating instruction, that doesn't mean dumbing down curriculum. You figure out a standard. And so your kids are at, like, your intermediate students will look at them as kids that are at about grade level. All right, so that's our goal. So we provide the activity for them. Now, for the beginning students, maybe want to add a whole bunch of extra supports, like maybe some visual supports, manipulatives, things like that. And then for your more advanced students, the way I usually differentiate is advanced students usually, they like to really get involved, like by expressing their opinions, things like that. So, you know, just give more work to the advanced student because that makes them decide, well, I'm not going to, no reason for me to do any better. But give more challenging work, something that interests them a little bit more, something that definitely attracts their opinion. You know, you want to really draw on all of your students in your classroom, especially if you have all ESL students, you're going to have huge discrepancies in the amount of proficiency in your students. And just like Lourdes was talking about, maybe you have some kids that are really good readers, but they're not necessarily great writers. And so you want to match those kids with kids that are a little bit better writers, give them some good models. That's why I'm such a big fan of a really good dual language program. When you have like half your class are ESL students, the other half are native English speakers. That is such a great ideal situation to me because you have models for both languages that way. They can help each other. And again, you know, when I used to have Spanish speaking aides, because my Spanish wasn't the greatest, but I did know how to read and write pretty well in Spanish, and if it drive me nuts, I might even write something on the board because her grammar was just atrocious. And so I actually corrected it all the time. And so I wanted to model proper Spanish grammar to my students. It was very important. So I want to make sure those models are out there. Your role as a teacher is really being a facilitator and listener to really encourage your kids to speak up. I mean, speaking up is what leads us to writing. I mean, speaking and writing. much expressions, false expressions. So when we listening are a little bit more, you're taking in information. I really like to get kids excited about learning, but give them interesting topics to learn about too. So you really want to feed on your students' interests. So like if you got like a lot of kids about basketball, you could ask them about the Butler Duke National Championship game. We can get to think about that. I was in a YouTube group yesterday. For some reason, we were talking about Curious George, and I read a great biography on Margaret and H.A. Ray, who are the creators of Curious George. This is fascinating. I never knew this, but they were trapped in Nazi Germany in 1939, and if they had not escaped, the world would have never been exposed to Curious George. And so this is a writing assignment I used to give to students was, okay, I want you to write about the people that didn't escape. I mean, maybe one of the people that died in concentration camps was the person that had the cure for cancer, or had a way of creating a renewable energy that could supply the planet forever. A lot of these thinking in those terms, it's very important for me to just think of what if, what if is the, the two greatest words for any author are what if. What if there was a school that taught kids how to become magicians? What if, what if people fly, things like that. All right, I'm going to talk long enough again. I want to show you another fun clip. This is a clip from Living Color. Wasn't that a great show? I loved Living Color. In Living Color, this is a fun little language skit. This is about the on Ebonics program. So enjoy this 2.5-minute clip from Living Color.
How many times have you found yourself stranded in a bad neighborhood? You just couldn't speak their language.
Yo, you see that section lacking the folks up, man? Boom, shout out to you, man.
Well, now they've got both on Ebonics. It's my new home study course that teaches you how to speak Black English, just like the homies in the hood. Word.
Aw, oh, man, you brought us so white, right? Just as kids are going to share your image, and don't mean the white one don't got my head skills, right? All that's the thing, he's tied-ass, old mama, and count his money with his, I'm gonna join the Marine Corps at age 30s.
You can't help you with daily life. You can choose to help you understand what big kids on every healing show are saying. It is perfect for you Black urban professionals who are close to having your ghetto capacity, folks.
Standard type of writing, and that's again something to pay attention to in a different way, expressive writing and academic writing. And I mean, this is one of the things I think, especially with our beginning ESL writers, we really want to focus on getting these expressive ideas, you know, don't focus so much on the grammar and things like that. But then we do have a responsibility as soon as we show them how to succeed in a more academic setting. I mean, you're obviously not going to write a business memo using patois or Ebonics or something like that, or Appalachian or Spanglish or whatever dialect you want to talk about. So it's really important for kids to see the different models of different things. I think that's fantastic. Okay, so let's get into a writer's workshop. How do we facilitate a writer's workshop for our ESL students? Again, I think writer's workshop works with all students, especially with our ESL students. So we go into our pre-writing stages and our pre-writing. The important thing is using oral language to develop their need and desire to write. So we want to talk about our shared experiences. I mean, I think we can learn so much from the Japanese in Japan. By law, 31 school days a year are mandatory field trip days. I mean, that's fascinating to me. You know, we're lucky enough to get one every 3 years. But, you know, you can either gripe about the problem or you can do something about the problem. I mean, if you can't take your kids out into the world, your job is to bring the world into your classroom, folks. We live in Los Angeles and almost 200 different universities and community colleges in the area. I mean, I used to bring people to my classroom all the time. I get my students in college are predominantly African American and Latino, and I always get a lot of students from Iran and India and Taiwan to come to my classroom. I mean, it does take a lot to impress a first grader. They're like, you know, they go up to a Taiwanese student, they're like, "Hey, who speaks Vietnamese?" And the person speaks a little bit of Mandarin. They'll go, "That's awesome." And my kids just write about those experiences all the time because they're all in those shared experiences. I mean, one time we took a trip to the LA Zoo, and my kids wrote for the next month. I mean, and for the first week, they were even writing about the zoo on the bus ride over. I taught them to do this to truck drivers, and I just thought that was the greatest thing on the planet. So you got to give your kids lots of shared experiences. It's really important. In the pre-writing stage, you want to brainstorm ideas. You can do this with graphic organizers and create your mind maps or your DWL charts or your Venn diagrams or whatever. But definitely brainstorm, get some ideas out there. There's all kinds of great computer software out there that helps with creating a lot of these graphs, like inspiration, inspiration, things like that. It's really important to talk a lot about ideas, though, bounce ideas off of different people, because what might seem like a good idea to you might not be too attractive an idea to somebody else. So I'm a big fan of bouncing ideas off of others. Just because writing in school is tightly condensed into a 30-minute lesson does not mean that each writer can get his writing done in a timely way. So what I mean by that is, you know, you have some kids, you give them 30 minutes, they're going to be able to finish in 30 minutes, but there's a lot of kids that cannot finish in 30 minutes. So you have to expect this, especially if you have those different discrepancies among your ESL students. You have beginning, intermediate, and advanced. Obviously, your advanced students have a significant edge over the beginning ones. So I've always said it's one of the same things we strive for in America, is you fall. Kids don't need to be treated equally. They need to be treated fairly. Some kids don't need any help at all. Some kids need a lot of extra attention. You know, actually, all kids need some type of attention. It's very different the needs of each student. After pre-writing, we get to our drafting stage. And drafting is just really trying to capture ideas from our students. Again, I like getting kids to get those ideas down. I'm not into, especially, you know, in a drafting stage, I'm not going to be worried about really much of anything. I want kids to show me what they're interested in and get those ideas down, and we'll develop something from there. Okay, after the kids write their first draft, what we're going to start doing is revising. The revising stage is, you know what, I'm tired, I'm going to start, I'm going to show a clip right now. Before we get into the revising, I'm going to show a clip. This is the final clip from the movie Wordplay, and then we'll go into revising. I want to make sure to break it up, because I want to get through all these clips today. So, this next clip is the final clip from the movie Wordplay, which is available on Netflix. I encourage all of you to get it. This is just final thoughts from different people who were profiled in the film Wordplay. It's about a 1 minute clip, so enjoy it.
Something that will be feeding basically me to figure things out. Because I'm going to be a puzzle that you can do a puzzle game, so maybe you can just
So the movies weren't planned, there was not a shot in that, as that last song, the or some of the phone calls. That's one way, I think, to help improve people's writing, especially our ESL students, is to really improve their vocabulary. I think one of the best ways to improve your vocabulary are through crossword puzzles and the phone, like the president had said. So now we're talking about revising, and I just want to go through some ideas about revising with our ESL students. Revise allows students to share and discuss the content and clarity of their writing. And I think it's really important during revising to talk about it with other students. And it doesn't necessarily, during a writer's workshop, I guest a couple of semesters ago, John Goss, a friend of mine, teaches over at Lomita Magnet School. And I've never seen a teacher teach writing a writer's workshop in such an effective way as John does with his fifth graders. So he's got three ESL students, and they are just fantastic writers. The reason is because he really is facilitating an environment where the students are helping one another. They are talking to at least three other peers before they ever talk to him. He's just kind of there as a coach to help guide them along, but he's really getting the students to act as teachers. I think it's really important for kids to provide feedback to one another. Revising helps students expand their thinking, communicate more expressively. Again, lets them give feedback to one another. To be useful, peer responding must be modeled, though, and taught as part of the writing process from the very beginning. So it's very important, again, to model this. Model, model, model. I like to get kids to, just something I used to do, is I would get a kid, and we'd put them in a group of, like, four other students, and the kid would read their writing, and the other students in the group would give their feedback, and then each of those students had to do the same process. And what I find teaching kids how to do is how to give constructive criticism. But it has to be, they do have to provide feedback that's actually somewhat useful to students. It's not just praise for writing, because a lot of kids don't want to say anything bad about people's writing. Well, you can provide some guidance for a student without making them feel bad about it. I read things all the time. I just handed an article for California Review. I was providing feedback for an author, and I said, the article's too long. I think it could be two articles. Why don't you break it up into two articles, focus on these things. I'm very complimentary to it, but I was pointing out some things that I think could be improved, and that's something that we want to model to our students. And then when we do have an individual writing conference between a student and a teacher, it's really important that the student actually leads the way. Questioning helps the teacher understand the student's topic and focus and models appropriate questions. Students can later ask themselves to put their thoughts on the paper. But again, I want the student to be the one leading the conference. So what do you think about this? What is it that you really want to get out of what you're writing? Writer speaks first to set the agenda and communicate the intended meeting, and the teacher may then respond to specific solutions. So what's the main point of this and things like that? Okay, we're going to get to editing, but before editing, I should show another clip. Okay, so this is going to be a short clip. This is a clip, I'm trying to show you some funny things interspersed up with writing things. This is just a funny clip during the Super Bowl a few years ago. Carl Spencia, a very funny man, he did a whole series of commercials for Bud Light about teaching English as a second language. This is just a very brief 30-second commercial for Bud Light that Carl Spencia did. I think it's funny about teaching ESL students. Hope you enjoy it.
Hey,
So who is this guy who's doing blood pressure commercials in the morning? As I'm probably an evil person, I didn't put that to promote the beer and everybody. I put that because I thought it was a funny commercial. Now we're going to talk about editing, and then after editing, we'll get into our break for the day. So editing, takes place after the messages complete. And folks, I've been going through all these writing stages. These were developed by Don Gray, who's out of his researcher out of Australia. And you understand that none of these stages is more important than another. They're all simultaneously important. They're kind of like your five senses. One of the questions I always ask people is, what's more important, your arms or your legs? Well, hopefully your answer is, well, they're both important. Yeah, they are both important, so don't try and prioritize. And the reason I'm saying this right now is because I often see teachers really spending a lot of time editing with students, and that's really one of the best ways to get kids, not just ESL students, to get all students to need writing. So editing is something, this stage is particularly important in writing. We're trying to write in a more formal way to point out errors and things like that. But when you're correcting errors with your students, correcting errors means providing feedback on something that's systemic. When you see something that's being repeated, 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 that's when you might want to model something appropriately. If a kid makes a mistake every now and then, all of us make mistakes every now and then. I don't even think it's worth your time to point it out. But when you see something where it's just, they're phrasing a verb in the wrong way or something, and it's repeated several times, that might be something you want to just point out to a student. And they're always grateful for it. It's not a big deal. Just again, remember your tact. In the early stages of writing English, fluency is much more vital than accuracy. So again, I really want to emphasize to teachers, really it's most important to me for students to learn how to get those ideas down on paper. There's always going to be mistakes. That's what I love about it. I always use lots of newspapers in my classroom. I used to be a journalist, and I think newspapers are great. One of the reasons I love newspapers is I've always thought of the inner city, and you show me a McDonald's in the inner city, it doesn't have at least five free newspaper stands out front. The reason I've shown this to kids is now I'm showing them how to get reading materials that they can take into their homes, and so their homes now have more reading materials. And there's something for everybody in the newspaper. I love newspapers, but you take the New York Times, which is one of the most prestigious newspaper on the entire planet. The New York Times goes through at least four highly educated editors every single night. On any given morning, you can show me the front page of the New York Times, and I can find at least one mistake. And you show me a small town newspaper, I can find 300 mistakes on that front page. But why am I saying this? I'm always trying to point out to kids, don't freak out about editing. It's never going to be perfect. It's more important than you get those ideas down on paper, especially with my ESL students. I want to hear those ideas and see them, and then we can revise them and worry about the editing later. But get those ideas down. You don't want to lose an idea. And I want to just take risks. I really like to encourage risk-taking. I saw a great speech by James Cameron. He was talking about his work with NASA, where he was doing a lot of these underwater sea dives. He works pretty closely with NASA. And he said it was interesting because NASA has a saying, failure is not an option. And James Cameron said he totally disagreed with that saying. He says failure is not only an option, it's very important. You know, he talked about, you know, The Abyss, which was like one of his least successful commercial films, yet it helped him create all kinds of different technologies which would later be used for movies like Titanic and for Avatar. So the point that James Cameron made in his speech, that was a public speech, he said, failure is an option. Fear is not an option. And I'm like, wow, I'm adopting that immediately. I think that's fantastic. So I want to encourage my kids to take risks, be willing to fail. You know, I used to always tell my kids, if you're not making 20 mistakes a day, there's no reason to be here. You know, you got to be finding new things all the time. And I think as teachers, we need to develop that kind of environment. And for writing, I think that's one of the best ways to get kids so that they start to enjoy writing. You know, the more we can get kids to enjoy writing, the more likely they're going to do it for themselves. And that's really what we want to breed as teachers. I just got an email from Kimberly. Thank you so much, Kimberly. Kimberly's always emailing. She writes, as a physical education teacher, we would give task sheets to complete during a lesson. Learning a new skill. We could also have them write a one-page paper on a sports article, but what other examples could you give to me to help students with their writing? I said that those are great ideas for a PE teacher, Kimberly. First of all, I'm so happy to hear that there's still a PE class out there. But I was talking about things like for stress purposes, like having kids write lists, you can have them write directions. You know, if you really want to be ambitious, have the kids create a manual, manuals for different activities. Have created their own reader's guide, health books, you know, that's actually something to motivate them. I mean, health books are some of the books that sell more than any others. You know, why not, Beverly, why don't you encourage your kids to create the first, I don't know what grade you're teaching, maybe it's high school, but have your high school students create a book and actually publish it. You know what, you never know. I mean, some of the best-selling books on the market out there are published by students, and I haven't seen one yet published by students about health. Also, actually, you email me. I had a great gal, Sandy Slade. I had her on a couple of semesters ago. She has this whole program called Scholastics, which encourages PE in schools. She might be a great resource for you. Many of your students can work with her. So just email me that, Kimberly, so I can email you her information. I really appreciate your email. And then I got an email from Nancy. Thank you, Nancy, for emailing. Nancy writes, I was thinking in second grade, I observed a teacher who would put a word of the day on the board. Good. Can we do something similar to that for writing? For example, question of the day, where students write a couple of sentences to answer the question, then select native English speakers and ESL students to share their answer. Absolutely, I call that thinking, Nancy. Do a question of the day. You know, I used to do questions of the day every day. There's lots of different websites that provide them to students. Well, there's one website, I can't remember, I think it was like econedlink.gov or something, but they used to always ask great questions of the day, like, why does Brett Favre make $8.5 million a year for throwing a football and your teacher is driving a 30-year-old vehicle? It's great questions like that to get kids thinking. So I think that's a great idea, Nancy. It's a great way. But again, find out if the kids like it, though. What you want to do is promote things that the kids like, because you want them writing without you having to stress it. You email back anytime, Nancy, you always do. Currently wrote, thank you, currently. She writes, because each student will take a different amount of time in these writing stages. What you do with these students who finish fast, or probably what you're doing is a writer's workshop, is you have kids that are actually in different stages, and they can be working on lots of different projects, and that's where differentiation comes in handy, too. The types of books you get are going to be different. I mean, some of your higher students are going to produce really extensive materials, a lot more sense than some of your lower students. But again, you're challenging them in something that they're actually interested in. Probably continues to write, and what do you do with students who need a lot of extra time? Again, you're going to ask some kids like that. I know you can send it home as homework, but what if it isn't getting done at home? Yeah, I would agree with that statement, especially Carly. I never send anything home for homework that I think is too difficult, because I just don't. A lot of my kids, they aren't getting that support at home. I mean, what I will do, and you're not going to love this answer, is I often keep my classroom open an hour before the day begins and an hour after the day begins to work with kids that need that extra help, and they always appreciate it. And I have, you know what, I've also disclosed, anybody can teach. It takes a lot of hard work to be a good teacher. It takes a lot of time, and as Ray Smith said, there really are no shortcuts. If you really want to be a good teacher, you got to put the time in. I know that's not a popular answer. Unfortunately, I think it's pretty much the answer. So, the ESL teacher's optimal response to any written composition errors should follow two cardinal principles, I say. Attention to the communication of meaning is paramount, and the ESL student is better served who's guided towards self-correction. All right, so that's what editing, that's what I think we should be thinking about. Okay, we're at a little bit after 10. I always like to take about a 10-minute break, so go grab a coffee, go to the restroom, and when we come back, we'll continue our talk about how to facilitate environments where our students love to write, our ESL students in particular, and I'm going to show you a whole bunch more of great video clips. I'll see you in 10 minutes, everybody.
You are watching PhD, the television program of California State University.
I am Dr. Carter, director of the Ontario and Health University. We're looking for a new self-esteem development in spring 2010 and invite you to attend our exhibition students. Art of Ink, traditional and contemporary calligraphy with sealed images. Using symbols as written word, the wisdom and art of calligraphy remains one of the most revered, functional, and artistic traditions in East Asia. This exhibit will feature 30 recent works of calligraphy by artists locally and abroad. The exhibit represents some of the major trends of practice today, reflecting a diversity of approach as well as celebrating common traditional roots. Consider a special form of calligraphy, sealed images which are carved in stone and usually based on ancient Chinese scripts, have a strikingly modern appeal. A collection of 20 actual seals and their impressions. this exhibit. Please join us at the University Art Gallery in California State University to make us feel so forward to seeing you at our exhibition cinemas. Hi, my name is Elizabeth Perez. I came from Rancho Navarro in San Diego, and my major is digital media arts and TV. I chose CSU Community Schools because I heard it had a very good TV program, and I liked it because it was easy to read books on, and it seemed very nice and it was really very cool.
Attention businesses in the South Bay of Los Angeles. The South Bay Resource Network and the South Bay Home Stops are here to help you grow.
I found out about the One Stop representative in my store, the person in the services that we provide.
Been amazing. We've opened over 4,000 applicants. And One Stop really helped us find the true gems and how to hold us in.
On the business side, how the One Stop provides not only training, but it provides resources for contacts, also provides a resource for training and also takes on their professional trainees and facility that we offer. The classes are very easily
available. It was just a great experience. The members of the One Stop were always helpful in understanding
the services designed to help your business succeed. So, the Bay Resource Network is here for you. Call 310-970-7799 or visit our website at southbayresource.net.
One Stop is your resource for business in the South Bay.
This is my university.
Nice paper.
Tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is
staff here about doing theater. So Pasha has a team that's doing theater to make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. After we'll do a play reading of a play song, so getting into American culture and our Asian immigrants, and that makes it fun to those who are here on campus. Other teachers is definitely come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we bring like culture clashes and our student theater company to help our students learn community-based theater tradition. And touring shows is interesting everywhere. We take folk tale, we create a folk tale for our own. Sound is talking passes. And we tour in some great classrooms. So what Tantra does is both educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues and has more of a direct purpose for society.
My name is Marcus Jordan. I'm from the state of Cal State Vegas. I graduated from Santa Monica College, and I love the environment here at Cal State Vegas. I'm majoring in communication right now, and I love the program. The teachers are great. The environment is awesome. I enjoy being here.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Vegas Goodies offers a master's degree in humanities. With a focus on the cities of New York, this master's degree earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Quietly, call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
On this job, safety is our first concern. There's a lot that can go wrong. Unfortunately, we have Cal State to make a sales. Only authorized OSHA training center in the Los Angeles area. If you are in need of OSHA certification, or if safety is one of your concerns, call 888-4LA-OSHA and learn how to be safe. Remember, safety comes first.
My friend was trying to say that she loved peaches the most.
Instead, she said, "I'm the man found by Los Desnudos," which translated means, she loved naked men. Thank you for that one, Victor. That's Victor. I can tell you, when I lived in Spain with my host family, I didn't know a lot of Spanish, and so my host family was always trying to get me to talk, and my host mom, she said, "You don't talk very much, why?" And I wanted to say, "Well, I'm afraid, because I don't know much Spanish," and so to say I'm afraid is tengo miedo, but instead I said tengo mierda, which means I have to do number two in the bathroom, and they looked at me very oddly, and then I said, because I realized what I said. I said, "Estoy embarazado," thinking I was saying I'm embarrassed. Instead, I was saying I'm pregnant. Not that easy, folks. Let me see if we got another one. Oh, and then this one comes from Rachel. Thank you, Rachel. Rachel writes, "Telling myself several years ago, I wanted to refer to a friend of mine as a gentleman, caballero, and instead I called him a caballo, which means horse." So thank you for that one, Rachel. I love that, folks. I really enjoyed this class. Really participating quite a bit. For those who enrolled in the class, I just want to remind you, next week in class, it's April 24th, you have your fifth assignment due, which is your opportunity to teach me back a concept, something that you found interesting from this semester. So it's your turn to teach. You're going to either, you can create a song, you can create a little YouTube video, you can do a little essay, you can create a little PowerPoint, whatever you want. Some of you have already posted. And then it's only 2 more weeks. It's our last class, and that'll be your final exam. Remember, the final exam is just, you're going to have to tell me all the magic words. So as long as you've been viewing, you're going to have no problem on that final exam. Before we get to publishing, which is our stage of our writer's workshop, I want to show you a clip. I don't want to show this clip all semester. I don't remember why I didn't get to it. But, I think Brad Pitt is such an underrated actor. I think the reason he's underrated is because he's good-looking, and some people just assume he's not a very good actor. I think this guy's been kind of robbed at the Academy Awards. I think he's done some incredible roles. He's like Johnny Depp. They think that just because they're good-looking doesn't mean they're good actors. I couldn't believe that Benjamin Button didn't get more recognition. I thought that was a fantastic movie. I thought Brad Pitt was excellent. And yet, another great role he had was in the movie Snatch, where he plays a guy that speaks a very different type of English. So this is a clip from the movie Snatch, and I hope you enjoy this real short clip from the movie Snatch with Brad Pitt.
Sorry about the lag, but since you can't
in that movie can understand a word he's saying. That's from the movie Snatch, and that leads us to publishing our ESL students writing. Publishing, this is what gets kids excited about writing, so you have to have all folks on publishing. What's going on with it? I think I just don't get along. I want to have the kids write a book and have a publishing. You want to get the kids motivated to write something. Publishing, one of Scholastic's best selling books is called September 12th. We Knew Everything Would Be All Right, and it was written by a first grade class in Missouri. And it's just the kids' drawings and little writings about what they did after September 11th, and just a fantastic little book. I know, you know, when I'm publishing kids' stuff, and so I'm always publishing kids' stuff, you know, you put their writing on posters, and put posters all over the place. We used to put them on telephone poles. You know, you come here to any college campus, they have bulletin boards, put the kids' writing on the bulletin boards. You know, here in Hollywood, maybe the kids get discovered, they become an overnight success. You know, I had one kid, he used to like to put his writing at the post office right next to the America's Most Wanted signs. You know, you put them at Borders, because then the kids would say, oh, have you seen my writing? It's on display over at Borders. You can have the kids create their own classroom newspapers. You can have the kids create a cookbook. That's a great idea, because then every kid has a recipe from home. So now you're including the families in on it. So the kids create recipes and put them into a cookbook. I used to do my my Joe Friday. I go to Kinko's. I take out my wallet. I'm an inner-city teacher. Would you mind photocopying this and binding it for free for me? If they say no, bring a kid. You know, I always have my kids look hungry. Like, please, we're hungry for knowledge. You know, they always give it. You know, Kinko's is always great to teachers. I mean, when you tell a person you're a teacher, you might as well just tell them you have the answer. You know. People are like, what do you do for a living? I'm like, I'm a teacher. But they said that. Really? That's right, man. That's right. Just don't breathe on it. All right, so build on that empathy all the time. Again, you just write blogs. I've talked about PowerPoints. There's so many different ways to publish students writing. You should be publishing it all the time. I used to have kids create trading cards. I can't tell you how many boys I got interested in reading. I started off with Peyton Mary's football cards, but then we created cards for all the students in our classroom, and then we did them for all the teachers, and for cafeteria workers, and janitors, and stuff like that. You know, so there's lots of different ways to publish students' writing. So I highly encourage you to actively promote that. Okay, so we've been talking about writing, so this next book is as an inspiration. Erin Gruhl, she taught over at, was it Wilson in Long Beach? I can't remember, one of the high schools. It's Wilson in Long Beach. And if you've ever seen Erin speak, she's an amazing speaker. She teaches adjunct over at Cal State Long Beach. I know a lot of her professors used to be Mary Ellen Bode, who's just one of the greatest people on the planet. Mary Ellen is one of the authors of the PSYOP program for teaching kids how to be better readers, especially our ESL students. Well, Erin Gruhl, she wrote a book called The Freedom Writer's Diary, and it became a pretty big sensation, and especially became a sensation once Hilary Swank Greene did the film version of the movie. And, you know, this next clip I chose just because it shows how writing, one of the most powerful things about writing is it often gives a voice to kids that don't often have a voice. So this is about a 2.5 minute clip from The Freedom Writer's Diary with Erin Gruhl. This is with Hilary Swank. Enjoy this brief 2.5 minute clip.
My girls are graduating. My EBAT.
Miss D. Can I receive you from my diary?
That'd be great.
Can I just go with this position in your phone?
The summer was the worst summer in my short 14 years of life. It all started with a phone call. My mother was crying and begging, asking for more time, as if she were gasping for her last breath of air. She held me as tight as she could and cried. Her tears hit my shirt like bullets. Told me we were being evicted. She kept apologizing to me. That I have no home. I should have asked for something less expensive at Christmas. From the morning of the eviction, a hard knock on the door woke me up. The sheriff was there to do his job. around with this guy, waiting for something to happen. My mother has no family to be around, no money coming in. Why bother coming to school or getting good grades if I'm homeless? The bus stops in front of the school. I feel like throwing up. I'm wearing clothes from last year, some old shoes and only a haircut. I kept thinking I'd get after. Instead, I'm greeted by a couple of friends who were my English class last year. It is me, Mrs. Grewal. My crazy English teacher from last year is the only person that made me think of hope. Talking with friends about last year's English and our trips, I began to feel better. I received my schedule, and the first teacher is Mrs. Grewal, room 203. I walk into the room and feel as though all the problems in life are not so important anymore. I am home.
I mean, that's kind of stuff a lot of us have seen all the time in the classrooms. I mean, some of the home environments of our kids, it's just completely stupid. You never know that. And writing is the format for kids to express all those feelings. That's really powerful stuff. I don't know what you're going to do. I gotta confess, you know, his name's a little bit right. You know, she's smiling on her eye about the hope and stuff. And, you know, really provide a place for him to be for 7 hours a day. Really powerful stuff. Okay, so get us back on track about laughing, because I like people laughing. That's inspirational, very inspirational. The book is fantastic. I don't know if this is Grewal, the movie, but I was introduced to her once as Eric Grewal. I don't know how you pronounce the name, so I apologize, maybe it's Grewal. But this next clip, Mad TV, they decided to do a parody of the Freedom Rider's Diary, and a great professor here on campus, Dee Parker, her office used to be nice to me, and they switched all our departments and stuff, but Dee's one of the greatest people in the world, and Dee's daughter, Nicole, she's on Mad TV, and one of the funniest things that Nicole ever did is this parody of the Freedom Rider's Diary, so I hope you enjoy this parody entitled Nice White Lady.
Thank you.
absolutely love that. When it comes to teaching inner city students, you don't need books, you don't need rules, you just need a nice white lady. It's just fantastic. Anyway, I'm happy to show you something happy. The other thing is depressed me, so I want something to make me happy. Another thing that depressed me is, Jaime Escalante, my idol. He passed away a couple weeks ago. They're having funeral services for him today, memorial services in Garfield High. So if you are over there, you might want to attend some of those things. Okay, so let's talk about issues in ESL writing, some of the issues that we may encounter with ESL writing. Selecting a topic can sometimes be a concern for ESL students. They don't know what slices is something we're going to have to pay attention to and how to help them out. Not all writers find a topic of a personal nature, such as childhood experience, that offers plenty of ideas for writing. I mean, some people taste wild to badger them almost into getting something to write about. So we have patience and everything with that. And then again, being familiar with the topic doesn't guarantee he's going to be able to write that easily about a topic. There's plenty of things I know a lot about, but I don't know if I'm qualified to really write a lot about them. So this is something to pay attention to. And the fact that a topic is only with native English speakers is no guarantee that it will enable ESL students to write as well. I'm just going to break it down right into sports. I love football. Well, football to a lot of my ESL students doesn't mean football. American football means soccer. Now, if I had to write about soccer, a lot of them would be much more engaged with that kind of writing assignment than writing about American football, about the U.S. Trojan football team, So, again, a good ESL teacher is a good teacher. They're just figuring out what their students are interested in, building upon those interests all the time. Cultural differences abound, and teachers need to be aware of what students may or may not feel comfortable writing about. And again, we talked about culture in one of our early classes in here. You want to kind of walk the line on that. You don't want to get too controversial. You don't want to get freaking out on something we're writing about. So, just again, have respect and courtesy and open communication between you and your students is very important. Teachers also need to make sure that ESL students understand the different types of writing require different degrees of formality. So, let's say we're practicing text messaging. Well, text messaging doesn't require much formal English at all. Now, if we're writing a, let's say, a high school ESL teacher, I'm just trying to train students how to write their essays to get into prospective college, well, it requires a different type of writing than maybe writing an email, writing a poem, or something like that. So, it's really important that we facilitate lots of different types of writing with our students so that they are comfortable with all these different formats. Something I noticed, and you might be aware of this, is plagiarism isn't frowned upon in every culture. Like in America, we're pretty adamant against plagiarism. It's not so, I've had students that have no problem just totally plagiarizing. And I have Russian students. My Russian students always are just plagiarized, knowing all of us have this problem with plagiarism. And, so that was a cultural thing that I had to learn about. And I just had to kind of figure out that, it's not acceptable here in America. It's frowned upon. So I just had to educate them all that they didn't know that. And so that is an important thing. So educating our students on the norms of different types of writing. And performance, the other thing is, teachers need to ensure that ESL students do not rely too heavily on reference materials, as many ESL students may overuse your dictionaries or thesaurus or encyclopedias. They don't want a kid to write me an essay that's just based on something completely downloaded off of Wikipedia. I want them to express their own thoughts and opinions and things like that. And again, this is something that we're going to model all the time. Good modeling, preventative messages, and really good open discussions about this with your students will help them out quite a bit. Okay, now, this next film that I wanted to show you, I wanted to introduce you. I'm going to show more clips of this film in a couple of weeks. These last two movies I'm showing you are really great films. This one is a French film. It's actually the most successful French documentary of all time. It's called To Be and To Have. It's the English translation. And this is about Suspect Club. This is a preschool teacher in France. And he's got this great classroom. So anywhere from preschoolers all the way up to, I think, they're around sixth graders in one classroom. It's only about 15 to 20 kids. And this scene from To Be a Tab is one little boy whose name is Jojo. He's kind of a lazy kid, and the teacher is trying to get him to complete his writing activity. So enjoy this about a 6 minute clip from the film To Be and To Have.
Thank you. the agreement. Just the dirty boys and the girls. If he was a perfect duties,
it's called Me and Dehab. It's a French film. I'm pretty sure you can get it off Netflix. I don't think you can download it instantly, but it's a great film. To Me and Dehab, French film. That teacher just awesome. It's just gentle and giving the individual attention to the kids. I love the recess. It's always one of the describing recess. I'm going to show you clips from that in the last session because I think it's such an inspirational movie. I'm always trying to find great teachers to model myself after. I just think, well, man, he's just a great teacher. He's very different from me. I mean, I'm glad I'm like this. He's very gentle, soft-spoken gentleman, but you watch him. He's such an effective teacher to be able to have. I have two more clips from another movie I really wanted you to see, and so I want to make sure I get to both clips. The movie's called 2 Million Minutes. This is fascinating. Documentary. It's only about an hour-long documentary, and it compares two students in Carmel High School in Indiana, in the United States, two students, high school students in India, and then two high school students in China. And it's a pretty scary movie. It just shows you what's going on in all these different countries. America kind of needs to get its act together on certain things. And I don't believe all the doom that a lot of people present about the American education system, but I see that we're kind of starting to screw through some things up here. And, creative writing would be something I'd love to see us work a little bit more on. So this first one is only about 3 minutes. It just introduces you to the film 2 Million Minutes. Enjoy this 3 minute film.
Okay, so I do work like over the weekend. Let's see. On the Monday, I have to give a presentation in my macroeconomics class. And I started it on Sunday at about 4:30. So I was here working on that for the last bit of time.
Because I want to do pre-med, I know it's going to be a lot of studying, so it's not going to be so much fun. My mom has always said that college is kind of a big debt. It's just where you kind of learn to balance free time and study. I want to do a sorority, which obviously you can party a lot and you have some fun.
America is the one country doesn't seem to recognize that it's a competition for the green guys in the
capital. That's fair, big numbers. I will be pushing it in as well as I can. And just get a visual distance over to the note. You should. That is really easy. We got 10 minutes. Yeah, like 10 school resources. I mean, questions.
2 million minutes. I'm going to show you one more clip from that before the end of class today, but it's just to get you thinking about some things. When I was on, Denise emailed me. She wants me to talk a little bit more about next week's assignment. Next week's assignment is assignment 5. It's called Your Turn to Teach. It's on your blackboard for those who enrolled in the class. What we're going to do is you're going to take two of the concepts we've talked about in this course, and you need to teach them to me. How do you teach them in an interesting way? So you'll be talking about like anywhere from crashes, 5x5 to the difference between mixed and cal, or teaching ESL writing skills. Two concepts that you found valuable in this course, you're going to teach them in an interesting way. You can teach them in any format that you would like. You can create a lesson plan out of it. You can write a paper out of it. You can create a song about it. You can do a YouTube video. You can do a podcast, whatever you want. Give you complete. However you want to make that topic interesting. So hopefully that answers your question, Denise. That gives you a little bit of background. That's due next week, and then 2 weeks to our last class, and we'll have the final exam due then. We have not posted the final exam yet because I don't have all the matching words for you yet. But that'll be the final class on May 1st, and then we'll be all done. But you know what? I always appreciate some of you who come actually to my office to introduce yourselves. It's kind of weird teaching a class where I actually never get to meet any of the students. People look at me, I kind of feel like I'm on America's Most Wanted list or something. I don't know anybody I did for class 3 years ago. So I would love getting to meet everybody. So if you ever see me, please say hi. Appreciate it. Okay, well, I get to this other clip from 2 Million Minutes. And this gives you a little bit more background about these two, three very different academic environments. And I want to point out to you that the high school students that they're profiling in the United States are at one of the best high schools in the United States. I mean, this is one of the best high schools in the United States. So enjoy this about an 8-minute clip, and then we'll finish up with some writing tips for this is from 2 Million Minutes. Enjoy.
Good morning, our high school. This is Hillary Hoover for morning announcements. Straight up in the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God,
I'm Years from now, I don't know really what I'd be doing, but I think who I'll be as a person will, I don't think it's going to change much from who I am right now. Doing fine in the things. I guess that could be decided in college the next 4 years if I actually figure out what I want to do. I think I'll be happy with whatever I'm doing. I don't think I would do something for any amount of time. I don't think I have a career or something that I didn't want to do. Which means I probably won't be working in an office type situation. I don't think I ever want to have a cubicle. Maybe for a little bit if I can't find anything else.
1, 2, 3, 4. I got issues with Senate House because I'm chilling to help people. And I just think you get an awesome feeling. It's a really rewarding experience, I think, being able to save lives. I've always liked working with people. I'm just not 9-to-5 kind of girl. I don't like working in confined spaces. I like to have a bunch of, I like to be very versatile with the things I do. I think I'm more hands-on, and I love helping people. I think it'd be an awesome way to serve the community.
I know what it's feeling like this because it's a busy thing. And I have a better plan. Okay. I know I want a master's degree. And probably a PhD of planning.
All of you take the data, do the calculation individually. Nobody should say, I don't know how to find the tangible data. Three of you will take the paper, do the calculation. Do your standing simply then.
If I had a dog, I'd be able to message to my dad. And my dad then would help us too.
Yeah, actually, I think it's like the standard rule taken by everybody right now. Because in the IT strike is that's the job scenario, especially engineering and things. I want to be happy, like, official side of my job. I want to do something that I do every morning and do the small thing. It's really interesting and challenging every day. I'm assuming my age is degree to I'm in therapy and I'm really being on my own as I want to do this.
I'm going to学习生理之类，但是我觉得就是因为学生早上还有我总会有点感觉，如果遇见到那个遗憾，我可能还会觉得有点累吧。 我自己上学大学，我现在还是没有一个非常清楚的那个目标，但是我当然希望上一所一流的大学，然后在大学我想学一些关于生物方的专业。
就是说，从大学毕业还是特别的，就是都是这样子一个挺不错的，然后这样子的话，然后有成功了，我觉得我就有一点惊喜的感觉，这种惊喜的感觉。 想具体一下怎么工作的，是怎么的，然后我也是第一期发展上第一期是用来作业，然后但是有时候还是要做到就是爸妈都睡，然后有时候我就说是因为是发生一些比较紧的事情，然后想了以后就通过这段就是那个情况可能学习非常非常这种时间。回家以后吧，其实就是可以请我加入这个领域的所有的坐标，然后在电脑前面一段时间玩游戏，一段时间练习新兴趣。
Well, folks, we don't have much more time anyway. We're talking about writing. Hey, we might be doing bad math science, but we're doing a little bit better at writing. But, folks, it's been great this week. I will see you next week. Have a wonderful week. You make a difference. Okay, see you next week, everybody.